We made peace a symbol of ours. In the name of peace, we gather here now. Oh Lord, please make these days of ours on this earth filled with peace.
Peace TV, the solution for humanity.
I would like to welcome to the stage our speaker, Dr. Zakir Naik, speaking on the subject, the Quran and modern science, compatible or incompatible. I would like to give you now a brief introduction of Dr. Zakir Naik, and truly it is a brief introduction because there is too much to be said. He is a medical doctor by professional training and a renowned dynamic international orator on Islam and comparative religion. He is the president of the Islamic Research Foundation in Mumbai and clarifies Islamic viewpoints, clearing misconceptions about Islam using the Quran, authentic hadith, and other religious scriptures as a basis in conjunction with reason, logic, and scientific facts. He has completed all of this study in preparation by the age now of 41, still young, but Sheikh. He is popular for his critical analysis and convincing answers to challenging questions posed by audiences after his public talks. In the last 10 years, Dr. Zakir Naik has delivered more than 1,000 public talks in the United States of America, Canada, the United Kingdom, Saudi Arabia, the United Arab Emirates, Kuwait, Qatar, Bahrain, Oman, Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, Botswana, Malaysia, Singapore, Hong Kong, Thailand, Guyana, and South America, and many other countries, in addition to numerous public talks here in India. He has successfully participated in several symposia and dialogues with prominent personalities of other faiths. His public dialogue with Dr. William Campbell from the United States of America on the topic, the Quran, the Bible, and the light of science, was held in Chicago, the United States of America, in April of 2000, and was a resounding success by the grace of Allah. Sheikh Ahmed Didat, the world-famous orator on Islam and comparative religion, who had called Dr. Zakir Naik Didat Plus in 1994, presented a plaque in May of 2000 with the engraving awarded to Dr. Zakir Abdul Karim Naik for his achievement in the field of Dawah and the study of comparative religion. Son, what you have done in 4 years had taken me 40 years to accomplish, alhamdulillah, to end the quote of Ahmed Didat. Dr. Zakir Naik appears regularly on many international television channels in more than 200 countries of the world. He is regularly invited to TV and radio interviews. More than 100 of his talks, dialogues, debates, and symposia are available on DVDs, VCDs, video cassettes, audio cassettes, and he has authored several books on Islam and comparative religion. Ladies and gentlemen, without further delay, I would like to welcome Dr. Zakir Naik, President of the Islamic Research Foundation.
Alhamdulillah. والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أولم ير الذين كفروا أن السماوات والأرض كانت رتقا فتقناهما وجعلنا من الماء كل شيء هي أفلا يؤمنون رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي My respected elders and my dear brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you with Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, be on all of you. The topic of this evening's talk of mine is the Quran and modern science, compatible or incompatible. The glorious Quran is the last and final revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, which was revealed to the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. For any book to claim that it is the word of God, for any book to claim that it is the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it should stand the test of time. Previously, hundreds and thousands of years back, it was the age of miracles. And alhamdulillah, the glorious Quran is the miracle of miracles. Later on, more than 1,000 years back, it was the age of literature and poetry when the Quran was revealed. And alhamdulillah, Muslims and non-Muslim scholars alike, they claim the glorious Quran to be the best Arabic literature available on the face of the earth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the challenge of the glorious Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 23 and 24, which says, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا And if you are in doubt as what we have revealed to our servant, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, from time to time, فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّن مِّثْلِهِ Then produce a surah somewhat similar to it. وَدْءُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ And call forth your helpers and witnesses, if there are any besides Allah, if your doubts are but true. فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا And if you cannot, وَلَمْ تَفْعَلُوا And of a surety you cannot. فَاتَّقُوا النَّارَ الَّتِي وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ الْحِجَارَةُ أُعِدَّتْ لِلْكَافِرِينَ Then fear the fire whose fuel is men and stones, which is prepared for those who reject faith. Here the Quran gives a challenge that try and produce a surah somewhat similar to it. And the shortest surah is hardly 3 verses, hardly few words. No one has done it so far, and no one, inshallah, till eternity will ever be able to do it. But today, suppose a religious scripture in a very poetic fashion says that the world is flat. Will a modern man believe in it? But naturally no, because today is not the age of literature and poetry. Today is the age of science and technology. So let us analyze today whether this glorious Quran is compatible or incompatible to modern science. Whether does it pass the test of today, the test of modern science. According to Albert Einstein, the famous physicist and the Nobel Prize winner, he said that science without religion is lame and religion without science is blind. Let me repeat it, that Albert Einstein, the famous physicist and the Nobel Prize winner said that science without religion is lame and religion without science is blind. Let me remind you that the glorious Quran is not a book of science, S-C-I-E-N-C-E, but it is a book of signs, S-I-G-N-S. It's a book of ayats. And there are more than 6,000 ayats, 6,000 signs in the glorious Quran, out of which more than 1,000 speak about signs. As far as my talk today is concerned, I will only be speaking about scientific facts which have been established. I will not be speaking about scientific theories and hypotheses, which all of us know very well, that many a time these theories and hypotheses, they take U-turns. In the field of astronomy, in 1973, there were a couple of scientists who got the Nobel Prize. And these couple of scientists, they described the creation of the universe. And they called it the Big Bang. And they said that initially, our universe, it was a primary nebula. Then there was a Big Bang. There was a secondary separation, which gave rise to galaxies, the stars, the planets, the sun, the moon, and the earth on which we live. This they called as the Big Bang. The glorious Quran mentions this in a nutshell. 1400 years ago, in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 30, the ayah I started my talk with. And it says, Awalam yara allazina kafaru. Do not the unbelievers see anna samawati wal arda kanat ratka faftaknahuma, that the heavens and the earth were joined together and we clove them asunder. This verse of the glorious Quran speaks about the Big Bang in a nutshell, 1400 years ago, which science has discovered recently, hardly 30 years back, 35 years back. The glorious Quran says in Surah Fusilat, chapter number 41, verse number 11, moreover, he comprehended in his design the sky when it was smoke and said to it, and the earth, come ye together willingly or unwillingly. And they said, we come in willing obedience. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he said to the sky when it was smoke, come ye together along with the earth willingly, unwillingly. And they said, we come together in willing obedience. Today, the scientists, they tell us that initially the celestial matter of the universe, it was in the form of gas. And the Arabic word used in this verse of Surah Fusilat, chapter 41, verse number 11, is Dukhan. Dukhan does not merely mean gas, it specifically means smoke. And today scientists say that smoke is a more closer and more scientific as compared to gas, because that time it was hot. Imagine. The Quran mentions 1400 years ago, which we discovered recently, that the initial celestial matter of the universe, it was in the form of smoke. Previously, the human beings, we thought that the earth on which we live, it is flat. It was in 1577, Sir Francis Drake, when he sailed around the earth, he proved that the earth was spherical. Quran mentions in Surah Luqman, chapter number 31, verse number 29. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who merges the night into day and merges the day into night. Alam tara anna allaha yuliju layla fil nahari wa yuliju nahara fil layli. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who merges the night into the day and merges the day into the night. Merging is a gradual and slow process. The night slowly and gradually merges into the day, and the day slowly and gradually merges into the night. If the earth was flat, there would have been a sudden change. It would have been a gradual process of night merging into the day and day merging into the night. Allah gives a similar message in Surah Az-Zumar, chapter number 39, verse number 5. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who overlaps the night unto the day and overlaps the day unto the night. The Arabic word used here is kawara, which means to overlap or coil. So the Quran says it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who overlaps or coils the night unto the day and overlaps or coils the day unto the night. Coiling, the word kawara is used, how you coil a turban unto your head. So this overlapping and coiling of the night unto the day and the day unto the night is only possible if the shape of the earth was spherical. If it was flat, it was not possible. And Allah further says in Surah Naziat, chapter number 79, verse number 30, we have made the earth as an expanse and we have made the earth X-shaped. Wal ard ba'da zalika dahaha. Wal ardh ba'da zalika dahaha means, and then we made the earth egg-shaped. One of the meanings of dahaha is an expanse. And the other meaning of the Arabic word dahaha, it is derived from the Arabic word duya, which means an egg. And we know today that the earth on which we live is not completely round like a ball. It is geospherical in shape. It is flattened from the pole and it is bulging from the center. And the Arabic word duya doesn't mean a normal egg. It specifically means the egg of an ostrich. And if we analyze the shape of the egg of an ostrich, it too is geospherical in shape. Imagine, the glorious Quran mentions 1400 years ago that the shape of the earth is geospherical. It does not say spherical only, it specifically mentions like the egg of an ostrich. Previously, the scientists, they thought that the light of the moon was its own light. But Quran says in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 61, blessed is he, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has made the constellations in the sky and placed therein sun, that is a lamp, having its own light, and moon having borrowed light. The Arabic word used for the sun in the Quran, it is shams. And its light is always described as siraj, wahaj, or diya, which means a torch having a light of its own, or a blazing lamp, or a shining glory. Always the light of the sun is described as wahaj, siraj, or diya, meaning a light of its own. The Arabic word for moon is kamar, and its light is described as munir or nur, meaning borrowed light or a reflected light. There is not a single place in the Quran where the light of the moon is described as its own light. And the Arabic word for star is najam, and its light is described as saqib, meaning the light, by the time it reaches the earth, it loses its brightness, like a piercing brightness. The bright light, by the time it reaches, it consumes itself. And this message, that the sun has its own light, describing as wahaj, siraj, or diya, and the moon having borrowed light, that is munir, or reflection of nur, is mentioned in several places in the Quran, including Surah Yunus, chapter number 10, verse number 5, as well as Surah Nuh, chapter number 71, verse number 15 and 16. And the Quran says in Surah Tariq, chapter number 86, verse number 3, that wa najmus saqib, describing the star, its light as saqib, that means it pierces, it's a piercing darkness. Previously, the European scientists, they believed that the earth was the center of the solar system and the universe. And all the planets, as well as the moon and the sun, it revolved around the earth. This was called as geocentrism. And this was believed since the time of Ptolemy in the 2nd century BC till as late as 16th century, until Nicholas Copernicus in 1512, he propounded the heliocentric theory of the planetary motion, and he said, it is the sun which is the center of the solar system, and all the planets, as well as the earth, it revolves around the sun. And later on, a German scientist by the name of Johannes Kepler, in 1609, he wrote in his book by the name Astronomia Novae, that not only do the planets and the earth, they revolve around the sun, but they also rotate about their own axis. And when I was in school, I passed my school in 1982, about more than 25 years back. There I too read that the planets and the earth, they revolve around the sun, and the planets and the earth, they rotated about their own axis. And the whole solar system, also in the galaxy it revolved, including the sun, but the sun did not rotate about its own axis. In this context, the sun was stationary. But when I read the verse of the Quran in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 33, which says, "Huwa allazi khalaqal layla wan nahar." It is Allah who has created the night and the day. Washamsa wal kamar, the sun and the moon. Kullun fi falaki yasbuhun, each one traveling in orbit with its own motion. So the Quran says, the sun and the moon, besides revolving, they also rotate about their own axis. The Arabic word used here is yasbuhun, derived from the Arabic word sabaha, which describes the motion of a moving body. If I use this Arabic word yasbaha for a person who's moving on the floor, it will not mean that he's rolling, it will mean he's either walking or running. If I use the same word for a person in the water, it will not mean he's floating, it will mean he's swimming. Similarly, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the same word for a celestial body, it does not mean that it is flying in the air, it means it is moving along with its own rotation. It is rotating about its own axis. So Quran says, the sun and the moon, besides revolving, it also rotates about its own axis. And today, science has discovered that even the sun rotates. Since we can't see the sun directly, you get blinded if you see directly. If you have an equipment and have the image of the sun on a tabletop, we find that there are spots in the sun. And it takes about 25 days for the spots to complete one rotation, indicating that the sun takes approximately 25 days to complete one rotation. Imagine when I was in school, I was taught the sun was stationary, it didn't rotate about its own axis. And the Quran mentioned 40 years ago that it rotates. And now, alhamdulillah, most of the schools have incorporated that the sun also rotates. Further, we read in the Quran, it's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Yasin, chapter number 36, verse number 40. It is not permitted for the sun to overtake the moon, nor the night to outstrip the day. The moon and the sun. Kullun fi falaki yasbuhun, each one traveling in orbit with its own motion. Now the scientists say that the orbit of the sun and the moon is different. So there's no question of the sun overtaking the moon. That's what the Quran says. And today the scientists, they tell us that the sun is moving in a direction in the universe to a particular fixed direction, which is called as the solar apex. In the constellation of Hercules, also known as Alpha Lyra, at a speed of 12 miles per second. And today the scientists, they tell us that the sunlight we have is due to a chemical reaction which is taking place since billions of years. And one day, this chemical reaction will cease. And so will the light of the sun cease to exist. And so will the life on this earth cease to exist. But the scientists say it will take another few billion years. Quran gives a similar message in Surah Yasin, chapter number 36, verse number 38. وَالشَّمْسُ تَجْرِي لِمُسْتَقَرِ اللَّهَ, that the sun is running its course for a period determined, to a place determined. The Arabic word used here is mustaqar, which has two meanings. Either it means for a period determined, or it means to a place determined. And today science says that the sun is moving to a particular spot known as solar apex, and it will exist for a particular time period. So both the meanings of mustaqar, to a place determined, and for a period determined, according to science, is perfect. Imagine, Quran mentions this 1400 years ago. When I was in school, I had learned that there are three types of matter: solid, liquid, and gas. And previously, the scientists believed that the space outside the astronomical systems in the galaxy, it was vacuum. Lately, the scientists have discovered that there are bridges of matter in the interstellar space. It's not vacuum, and it is called as plasma. And they say this matter is in a form of gaseous matter, which has equal number of positive ions as well as electrons. And the Quran mentions 49 years ago in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 59. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has created the heavens and the earth, as well as things in between it. So Quran says there is matter in between the heavens and the earth, which today science, they say that this plasma can be considered as the fourth type of matter. Today science also tells us that the atmosphere of the earth, it acts like a filter and prevents the harmful radiations from outer space to come onto the surface of the earth. It prevents the X-rays and the ultraviolet rays to reach the surface of the earth, which is very important for the sustenance of life. If this filter of the earth's atmosphere wasn't there, then life would not exist on the face of the earth. The Quran says in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 32, that we have made the sky as a protected ceiling. We have made the heavens, the Arabic word is samawat, we have made the heavens, that is the sky, as a canopy well guarded. Today science has come to know that this protected ceiling, without this, life would have ceased to exist on the face of the earth. It was in 1925, a very famous scientist by the name of Edwin Hubble and a famous astronomer, he said that the galaxies are receding. That means the universe is expanding. The Quran mentioned 14 years ago in Surah Dhariyat, chapter number 51, verse number 47, that we have created the vastness of space. The Arabic word musyun means vastness or the expanding universe. The Quran mentions 14 years ago that the universe is expanding, which we have come to know recently, 80 years back, 90 years back. And according to Stephen Hawking, who's a very famous scientist, he writes in his book, The Brief History of Time, he says that the discovery of the expanding universe is the greatest discovery of the century, which is mentioned in the Quran 14 centuries before. There may be skeptics or some non-Muslims who will say it is nothing great that the Quran speaks about astronomy, since the Arabs were very well advanced in the field of astronomy. I do agree with them that the Arabs were advanced in the field of astronomy. But I would like to remind them, it was centuries after the Quran was revealed that the Arabs advanced in the field of astronomy. So it is from the Quran that the Arabs learned about astronomy and not the vice versa. And there were many things about astronomy mentioned in the Quran which the Arabs didn't speak about and which we have come to know recently. In the field of physics, several centuries ago, there was a theory which was called as atomism. This was advanced by the Greeks, especially Democrats, who lived 2300 years before. And according to this theory of atomism, atom is the smallest part of matter. And this was also known to the Arabs. And the Arabic word for atom, in Arabic, it's called a zarra. And the Arabs also agreed the smallest part of matter, nothing can be smaller than that. And if you read the Quran too speaks about the atom. Now, after science advanced in the field of physics, we agree that atom is the smallest particle of matter having the characteristics of the element, but an atom too can be divided. So does it mean that the Quran is outdated? Quran says in Surah Sabah, chapter number 34, verse number 3, as well as in Surah Yunus, chapter number 10, verse number 61, that when they say, that is unbelievers, that the final hour will never come, tell them it will surely come by the Lord, in whose knowledge is the unseen, and in whose record is the smallest detail of an atom. And there is nothing smaller or greater than an atom which is not there without being mentioned in his record. Clearly, that's propitious. So the Quran says that Allah has the knowledge of the unseen. The minutest detail of the atom is mentioned. And even things greater and smaller than the atom is very clearly mentioned in his record. So the Quran mentions 1400 years ago that there are things smaller than the atom, which science has discovered recently. In the field of hydrology, we learn about the water cycle in the school. The water cycle, what we learn in the school, was first described in 1580 by Sir Bernard Palissy. And we learned in school that the water evaporates from the ocean. It forms into clouds. The clouds move, they rise, they condense, and the water falls and flows back into the ocean, and the water cycle is completed. Previously, in 7th century BC, Thales of Miletus, he said it was the spray of the ocean which was picked up by the winds which fell into the interior as rain. People did not know how did the rain fall. In 7th century, Thales of Miletus, he said it was the spray of the ocean which was picked up by the winds and fell into the interior as rain. People did not know from where did the underground water come. And people believed, even in the time of Plato, that when the water fell, this water flowed by a secret passage into the ocean called as Tartarus. People did not know from where did the underground water come. So they thought it was the pressure of the winds on the water which forced the water into the interior. And even till as late as 17th century, people and great thinkers like Descartes believed in this theory. Even in 19th century, people believed in the Aristotle's theory that the water evaporated from the earth and cooled in mountain caverns which fed the springs. Today we know that the underground water is due to the seepage of the rainwater. And Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Zumar, chapter number 39, verse number 21, "Seest not thou that it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who sends on water from the sky and causes it to soak in the grounds, causes springs in the ground, and then causes sown field of various colors to grow." Quran mentions in Surah Rum, chapter number 30, verse number 24. It is Allah who sends down water from the sky and then gives life to the earth after it is dead. The Quran says in Surah Mu'minun, chapter number 23, verse number 18. It is we who send down water from the sky, and we can store it, and we can even drain it easily. The Quran says in Surah Hijr, chapter number 15, verse number 22, that we cause fecundating winds. The Arabic word used is lawaqi, which is the plural of laqaha, coming from laqi, which means to fecundate, which means to impregnate. We cause fecundating winds. We cause winds to impregnate, and then the water falls from the sky. And today we know that science tells us that the pollen is picked up by the winds and it impregnates the clouds. And the second type is the clouds, they join together. Then there's lightning and water falls from the sky. A similar message of hydrology and water cycle is mentioned in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 43. It is Allah who makes the clouds to move gently and then causes them to join, then makes them into a heap, and then water emerges from the sky. Quran says in Surah Rum, chapter number 30, verse number 48, that it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who makes the clouds to rise, then makes it into fragments, and then water falls from the sky. The Quran speaks about the water cycle in great detail. The Quran says in Surah Tariq, chapter number 86, verse number 11, Wasama izatil raji, which means by the capacity of the heavens to return. Besides the sky or the heavens acting like a protected ceiling, besides reflecting all the unwanted dangerous rays back into the space, it also returns back the water evaporation. What the water evaporates from the ocean, the sky, it sends it back onto the earth. And the Quran says in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse 43, that we cause water to fall from the sky, from mountains of clouds. And when we're traveling in an aeroplane, aeroplane wasn't there 14 years back, and when we look at the clouds below, we see it is like mountain of wool. The clouds, they appear as mountains. Imagine, Quran mentions that 14 years ago. Quran describes the water cycle in great detail in several verses. Besides the several verses I quoted, there are many other umpteen number of verses which speak about the water cycle. It's mentioned in Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 57. In Surah Rod, chapter number 13, verse number 17. In Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 40 and 49. In Surah Fatir, chapter number 35, verse number 9. In Surah Yasin, chapter number 36, verse number 34. It's mentioned in Surah Jashia, chapter number 45, verse number 5. In Surah Qaf, chapter number 50, verse number 9 and 10. It's mentioned in Surah Waqia, chapter number 56, verse number 67 to 70. It's mentioned in Surah Mulk, chapter number 16, verse number 30. You can go on only quoting the several verses of the Quran which speak about the water cycle. You can only give a talk on hydrology and water cycle in the Quran. In the field of geology, and the geologists today, they tell us that the radius of the earth on which we live is approximately 3,750 miles. And the deeper layers, they are hot and fluid. It cannot sustain life. And as you keep on going superficially, it keeps on getting cooler. And the superficial crust on which we live, it is hardly less than 30 miles in thickness. And the geologists, they tell us there are high possibilities that this superficial crust on which we live, it can shake. And today the geologists tell us, they talk about the folding phenomena which gives rise to mountain ranges. And because of this folding phenomena and because of this mountain, there is stability on the earth. The Quran says in Surah Naba, chapter number 78, verse number 6 and 7, we have made the earth as an expanse. Well, Jibala Autada and the mountains as stakes. The Arabic word Autad means stakes or tent pegs. Like how we put a tent peg into the ground, we see only a small portion on the top, the major portion goes deep into the ground. So the Quran says the mountains are like tent pegs. And today science tells us that the mountain has got deep roots. And the portion we see on the top is only a small portion, like the tip of an iceberg. The major portion of the iceberg is in the water, and only a small portion is seen on the top. And science tells us that the mountains are put firmly on the earth. And Quran gives this message 14 years ago in Surah Naziat, chapter number 79, verse number 32, as well as Surah Jashia, chapter number 88, verse number 19, that we have placed on the earth mountains standing firm. As far as the subject of geology is concerned, a book by the name The Earth, which is known as one of the best textbooks in the field of geology and is referred in most of the universities in the subject. And one of its authors, his name is Frank Press, who was the president of the Academy of Sciences of USA earlier, and was also the advisor to the ex-president of USA, Jimmy Carter. And he writes in this book, and he draws the mountain and shows that the mountain has got deep roots in the shape of wedge shape. And he shows that the mountain that is seen above the surface of the earth is only a small portion. The major portion has got deep roots. And he writes in this book that it is due to the mountain which prevents the earth from shaking. And this is exactly what is mentioned in the Quran 14 years ago in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 31, as well as Surah Luqman, chapter number 31, verse number 10, that we have placed on the earth mountains standing firm, lest it would shake with you. The Quran specifically mentions that the function of the mountain is to prevent the earth from shaking, which we have come to know recently. In the subject of oceanology, There's a verse in the Quran, in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 53, which says that it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has let free two bodies of flowing water, one sweet and palatable and the other salty and bitter. Though they meet, they do not mix. There is a barrier which is forbidden to be trespassed. The same message is repeated in Surah Rahman, chapter number 55, verse number 19. Maraj al-Bahrain yaltaqiyan, that we have let free two bodies of flowing water. Though they meet, they do not mix. There is a barrier, there is a barzakh which is forbidden to be trespassed. When the commentators of the Quran, when they try to understand this verse, all of us know very well, and we knew it earlier also, that there are two types of water, sweet and salty. But they could not understand the verse of the Quran, which says that there are two types of water, sweet and salty. Though they meet, they do not mix. There is a barrier which is forbidden to be trespassed. There is a barzakh. The mufassirins, the commentators, could not understand what did it mean. Today, after science have advanced, we have come to know that whenever one type of water flows into the other type of water, sweet water flows into the salty water, it loses its constituents and gets homogenized into the water it flows. This transitional homogenizing area, according to the Quran, is called as the barzakh. It is an unseen barrier. And this has been testified and verified when this verse of the Quran was showed to Prophet Zahir, who is a very famous marine scientist and a professor in oceanology in the University of Colorado in USA. And he said that what the Quran mentions 1400 years ago has been testified by science recently. And this phenomena can be seen even with the naked eye at the Cape Point, the southernmost tip of Cape Town in South Africa, where one type of water flowed into the other type. We even see that the colors of both these waters differ. Another good example is in Egypt, when River Nile flows into the Mediterranean Sea. And the best example is the Gulf Stream. It flows for thousands of miles. It starts from the Gulf of Mexico and goes to the east side of North America, travels upwards, then goes eastwards and travels to the west coast of Europe. It flows for thousands of miles, but yet the two waters are distinct. And if you're traveling in a ship towards the extreme of the Gulf Stream and take a bucket of water from the left side and a bucket of water from the right side, you'll find that one is sweet and the other is salty. Even the temperature between the two, they differ. Imagine, Quran speaks about this phenomena 1400 years ago. In the subject of biology, the Quran says in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 30, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ هَيْ أَفَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. We have made from water every living thing. Will you not then believe? Imagine in the deserts of Arabia, the Quran says, we have made from water every living thing. Who could have believed in it? Today, after science advanced, we have come to know that every living creature has got cells, and the basic substance of cell is cytoplasm, which contains about 80% water. And today, science tells us that every living creature contains about 50 to 90% water. Quran mentioned in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 45, we have created every living animal from water. The Quran says in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 54, we have created every human being from water. In the field of botany, previously we did not know that even the plants have got sexes, male and female. We have come to know about this recently. Recently means 100 years back, 200 years back, 300 years back. The Quran says in Surah Taha, chapter number 20, verse number 53, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who sends down water from the sky and with it brings various pairs of plants, each separate from the other. The Arabic word used, each separate from the other, meaning male and female. The Arabic word used in the verse of the Quran is azwaj, meaning spouses. Sexes, male or female. So Quran says that every kind of plant has been made into sexes, male and female. And today science tells us that all the plants, they have got male and female sexes. Even the unisexual plant, they have distinct characteristic of male and female. The Quran says in Surah Ra'd, chapter number 13, verse number 3, we have created every kind of fruit and pears, two and two. Even the fruits are created in male and female. And today we know that the superior plants, the end stage is the fruit. Before that stage is the flower, which has got stamens and ovules, male and female. And pollen comes and fertilizes, and then we have the fruit, having distinct characteristic of male and female. Even the parthenocarpic fruits, even they like banana, figs, certain types of pineapple, oranges, they have distinct characteristic. These are unfertilized fruits, flowers from unfertilized, the fruits obtained. Even they have distinct characteristics of male and female. The Quran says further in Surah Yasin, chapter number 36, verse number 36, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has created every animal in pairs and human being in pairs and even things which you know and don't know. Allah says he has created everything in pairs. So besides human beings, animals, plants, even things which we don't know. Today we know that things like electricity also have got positive and negative, the electrons and protons. And many things which we don't know. So Allah says, he has created everything in pairs. Things we know as well as things we don't know. In the field of zoology, the Quran says in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 38, we have made every animal that lives on this earth and every creature which has wings and flies in the air to live in community like the human beings. Today we have come to know that the animals and birds, like the human beings, they too live in communities. The Quran says in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 68 and 69, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has taught the bee to build its cells in hills, on trees and human habitations, and to eat of what the earth produces, and to find the spacious path of thy Lord with great skill. It was recently, just a few decades earlier, that a scientist by the name of Fawn Fresh, he got the Nobel Prize for describing the behavior and the movement of the bee. And what does the Quran mean by saying it has taught the bee to build its cells in hills, trees, human habitations, eat of what the earth produces, and find the spacious path of the Lord with great skill? Today, after science advanced, after Fawn Fresh described the movement of the bee, we have come to know that whenever a bee finds a new garden or a flower, it goes and tells its fellow bee the exact direction of that garden and flower so that it could collect nectar by a process known as the bee dance. So what we have come to know recently, Quran says, it has taught the bee to find the spacious path of thy Lord with great skill. Today, in science, we call it the bee dance. And previously we thought it was the male bee which was the worker bee. Today we have come to know that it is not the male bee, it is the female bee which is the worker bee. And the gender used in the Quran in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 60 and 69 is fasluki and kulli, meaning a female bee. No wonder Shakespeare in his play, Henry IV, he mentions about people talking among themselves about the bee, that the soldier bee, the male soldier bee, they go and report to the king. Today we have come to know it is not the male bee, it is the soldier bee. They are the female bees, which are the worker bees and soldier bees. And they don't report to the king, but they report to the queen. Imagine, even the gender of the worker bee, the soldier bee, is mentioned in the Quran as the female gender, which we have come to know recently. The Quran says in Surah Namal, chapter number 27, verse number 17 and 18, before Solomon marched his host of men, jinns, and birds, and when they approached a lowly valley of ants, one of the ants said, O ye ants, get into the habitations, lest Solomon and his host will trample you beneath the feet. People would think, what kind of a fairy tale book is the Quran? The ants speaking among themselves? No, we have fairy tale books. So what type of a fairy tale book is the Quran? The ants talking and speaking among themselves? After science has advanced, we have come to know the animal or insect which has the closest resemblance to the human being is the ant. The ants bury the dead the same way as human beings do. They have a sophisticated method of labor in which they have supervisors, managers, foremen, workers, etc. They have a sophisticated method of communication. They very often even meet to chat. They have marketplaces where they exchange goods. You know, souks, we have marketplaces. Even ants have got marketplaces where they exchange goods. And if in monsoon, during rainy season, if while storing the grain, if the grain gets wet, the ants get the grain in the sunlight to dry, as though they knew that humidity will cause rotting of the grain. And if the grain begins to bud, they chop off the bud as though they knew that budding will cause rotting of the grain. Imagine, Quran speaks about the lifestyle of the ants 1400 years ago, which we have come to recently. The Quran says in Surah An-Kabut, chapter number 29, verse number 41, as to those who take for protectors anyone besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they build for themselves houses like that of a spider. For verily, the house of a spider is flimsy. Besides the Quran saying that any human being who takes for protectors anyone besides Almighty God, Allah, they are building for themselves houses like that of a spider, talking about the web. And the house of the spider is flimsy. We know that the web is a very flimsy house. But besides this, today we have come to know that many a time the male spider is killed by the female spider. The relationship of the husband and wife is not good in the spiders. So besides the Quran talking about the flimsy physical nature of the house of a person who takes for protector besides Almighty God, is also talking about the relationships in the house. In the field of physiology, it was 600 years after the Quran was revealed that Ibn Nafis, he described the blood circulation. And 1000 years after the Quran was revealed, 400 years after Ibn Nafis, William Harvey made it famous to the world. So in our textbook, we know the blood circulation was first described by William Harvey. Actually, it was Ibn Nafis 400 years ago. This is all media. And today we know that the food we eat, it goes into the stomach, then goes in the intestine. Just in a nutshell, as far as physiology is concerned, about the blood circulation and the production of milk, the food which enters the intestine, the substance of the food, it enters into the bloodstream through the vessels of the intestine. And via the complex media, very often through the liver, via the bloodstream, it reaches almost all the organs of the body, including the mammary glands, which is responsible for the production of milk. So what we have come to know today about the blood circulation and the production of milk is mentioned in a nutshell in the Quran 1400 years ago. In Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 66, we say that verily in the cattle is a lesson for you. We give you to drink from what is within the body, coming from a conjunction between the constituents of the intestine and blood, milk which is pure for you to have. And the same message repeated in Surah Mu'minun, chapter number 23, verse number 21, that verily in the cattle is a lesson for you. We give you to drink milk, which is pure, that comes from the within the bodies of the cattle, and in it are various benefits, and of the meat you can eat. So Quran speaks about the blood circulation and the production of milk in a nutshell 1400 years ago. In the field of medicine, previously we did not know that the honey was obtained from the belly of the bee. The Quran says in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 69, from the belly of the bees, we give you a drink of varying colors in which there is healing for humankind. It was only 300 years before, approximately, we came to know that the honey was obtained from the belly of the bee. And now we have come to know that honey is rich in vitamin K as well as fructose. Recently, we have come to know that even the honey has got mild antiseptic properties. No wonder the Russian soldiers in World War II, they used the honey to cover up the wounds, which prevented the evaporation of moisture, and the healing in the wound was done with leaving of very little scar tissue. And due to the density of honey, germs and bacteria were prevented to grow in the wound. And if a patient is suffering from the allergy of a particular plant, if honey is obtained from that plant and given to that patient starts developing resistance to it. Imagine what science has come to know today. Recently, Quran mentions that in the honey, there is healing for humankind. In the field of embryology, there were a group of students who collected all the data that they could find in the Quran as well as the Hadith dealing with embryology. And they followed the verse of the Quran, Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse 43, and Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 7, which says, Fas'alu ahal zikri in kuntum la ta'lamu. If you don't know, if you are in doubt, ask the person who's knowledgeable. So these Arab students, they collected the verses of the Quran and the Hadith dealing with embryology and translated into English and presented it to Professor Keith Moore. That was about 30 years back, in the late 70s. And Professor Keith Moore at that time was one of the highest authorities in the field of embryology. And he was the head of the Department of Anatomy in the University of Toronto in Canada. When he went through all the translation verses of the Quran and the Hadith, he said that most of the verses of the Quran which speak about embryology are in perfect conformity with latest advances of embryology. But there are a couple of verses which I cannot say that they are right. Neither can I say they are wrong because I myself don't know about it. And two such verses were the first two verses of the Quran to be revealed, of Surah Iqra or Surah Alaq, chapter 96, verse number 1 and 2, which says, Iqra bismi rabbikal ladhi khalaq. Khalaq al insana min alaq. Read, recite, proclaim in the name of thy Lord who has created the human beings from something which clings, a leech-like substance. So Professor Keith Moore said, I don't know whether the human beings, the embryo, embryology means it's the study of the development of the human being, the early stages of human being in the womb of the mother, for those who don't know. He said that I do not know whether initial stages of the embryo, that's the initial stages of human being, it looks like a leech or not. So he went in his laboratory and under a very powerful microscope observed the early stages of the embryo and compared it with the photograph of a leech. And he was astonished at the striking resemblance. And later, when 80 questions were asked to him regarding embryology in the Quran and the Hadith, he said that if you had asked me these questions 30 years ago, that means from today more than 60 years back, I would not be able to answer more than 50% because embryology is a new branch of medicine which I developed recently. And whatever additional information he got, he included in the new edition of his book, The Developing Human. The Developing Human is one of the books referred by most of the students throughout the world in the first year of MBBS, first year of medical college. And even I, when I was in the first year of the medical college in Bombay, If we had to get just pass marks, we used to refer to the book written by Inderbir Singh. If you wanted to score in embryology, we had to refer to The Developing Human by Professor Keith Moore. So Professor Keith Moore, he incorporated this new information he got from the Quran and the Hadith into the third edition of his book, The Developing Human, which got the award for the best medical book written by a single author. And later on, this book was translated into several languages of the world. And Professor Keith Moore said that this information in the Quran cannot come from human source. The author of this Quran has to be Almighty God. And he said that he has no objection in agreeing that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was the messenger of this God. Imagine Prophet Keith Moore being a Christian said that. Quran says in Surah Tariq, chapter number 86, verse number 5 to 7, that does not man know from what is created? He is created from a drop coming forth from a space between the backbone and the ribs. What does the Quran mean by saying the human beings have been created from a drop coming from a space between the backbone and the ribs? Today, after science has advanced, we have come to know that the genital organs in the human beings in the embryonic age, when the child is in the womb of the mother, it developed from a space close to the kidney. That is a space between the spinal column and the 11th and 12th rib. In the male, the genital organ, the male gonads are the testes. In the females, the female gonads, they are the ovaries. And later on, in the embryonic age, these genital organs, the gonads, they descend. In the female, the ovary descends till the true pelvis. And in the male, via the inguinal canal, it descends to the scrotum. But even after descending in the adult life, yet these genital organs, they receive the nerve supply from the same space between the backbone and the 11th and 12th rib. And the blood supply from the aorta, which is present in the same space between the backbone and the 11th and 12th rib. And the venous return and the lymphatic drainage goes to the same space, the space between the backbone and the 11th and 12th rib. The Quran mentions in no less than 11 different places that the human beings have been created from a nutfa. It's also mentioned in Surah Hajj, chapter 22, verse number 5, and Surah Mu'minun, chapter number 23, verse number 13, that the human beings have been created from nutfa, which means a minute quantity of liquid. What does the Quran mean that we have created the human beings from a minute quantity of liquid? The Quran also says in Surah Sajdah, chapter number 32, verse number 8, that we have created the human being from a quintessence. And we have created the human beings from sulala. The Arabic word sulala, besides meaning quintessence, it also means the best part of the whole. So besides the Quran saying we have created the human being from minute quantity of liquid, it also says we have created the human being from the best part of the whole. And today science tells us that only one spermatozoa out of the millions of sperms that are emitted is sufficient to fertilize the ovum. Only one out of several millions. So this one out of several millions, the Quran refers as nutfa, minute quantity, and sulala, the best part of the whole. One out of several millions. The Quran further says in Surah Insan, chapter 76, verse number 2, we have created the human being from nutfatin amshaj, from a minute quantity of mingled fluids. Today science says that both the male fluid and the female fluid, both are responsible for the birth of the baby. So minute quantity of mingled fluids. And besides the male and the female fluids, even the surrounding fluids take part, prostatic fluids, etc. In the field of genetics, today we have come to know that it is the sperm which is responsible for determining the sex of the child. And today science tells us that the 23rd pair of chromosomes in the human being, it determines the sex of the child. If it's XX, it's a female. If it's XY, then it's a male. So it is the sperm which is responsible for determining the sex. If the X of the sperm takes part in the fertilization, then a female is born. If the Y takes part, then a male is born. And this is exactly what the Quran says in Surah Najm, chapter number 53, verse number 45 and 46, that we have created the human being from a minute quantity of liquid, which is ejaculated. Minute quantity of liquid, ejaculated means it has to be a male fluid. The similar message is repeated in Surah Qiyamah, chapter number 75, verse number 37 to 39, that we have created the human being from a minute quantity of sperm. Nutfatan min man yumna. We have created the human being from minute quantity of sperm, then made it into an alaqa, then made the alaqa into mudga, then gave it sex, male and female. So the Quran says that the sperm is responsible for the sex of the child, whether it's male or female. In this country of ours, this great country, India, for reasons known best to the Indians, in India mainly, most of the people, they prefer having sons rather than daughters. And if a lady gives birth to a daughter, very often the mother-in-law, she will blame the daughter-in-law, that why did you give birth to a daughter? According to the science and the Quran, if the mother-in-law has to blame anyone, she should not blame the daughter-in-law, she should blame the son. Because it is the male fluid which is responsible for discerning the sex of the child, male or female. Actually, it's in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one who makes it male or female. But if the mother-in-law has to blame anyone, she should blame the son. Because he is responsible for the sex of the child, male or female. The Quran says in Surah Az-Zumur, chapter 39, verse number 6, that we have made the human beings in stages, one after the other, in three veils of darkness. According to Prophet Keith Moore, he said that this verse of the Quran, when it mentions the three veils of darkness, it refers to the anterior abdominal wall, the uterine wall, and the amniocorionic membrane, that the human being is made into stages in three veils of darkness. The Quran describes the various embryological stages in great detail. The Quran mentions in Surah Mu'minun, chapter number 23, verse number 12 to 14, that we have created the human being from a quintessence of clay, then made it into a nutfa, a minute quantity of liquid, then made the nutfa into alaqa, a leech-like substance, then made the alaqa into mudga, that's a chewed-like lump, then made the mudga into ezama, bones, then clothed the bones with lahim, that is flesh, and then we made a different creature. Glory be to Allah, who's the best to create. These three verses of the Quran describe the various embryological stages, the initial stages of development of a human being in the mother's womb in great detail. First it says that it made it from a nutfa, which we discussed, a minute quantity of liquid, then made the nutfa into alaqa, that means a leech-like substance, which we discussed earlier. The meaning of the Arabic word alaqa, it has got three meanings. One is a leech-like substance. It also means something which clings. And the third meaning of alaqa is congealed clot of blood. Besides it looking like a leech, the embryo in the initial stages, it also behaves like a leech, it behaves like a blood sucker, it derives its nutrition from the mother through the placenta. It behaves like a blood sucker. So besides looking like a leech, it also behaves like a leech. The second meaning, something which clings, we know that the embryo clings to the uterine wall. Throughout the 9 months that the fetus is in the womb of the mother, it clings to the uterine wall. The third meaning of alaqa is congealed clot of blood. And today's science tells us that in the initial stages, the blood does not circulate. And the blood clots in the vessels and appears like a congealed clot of blood. So all three meanings of alaqa, alhamdulillah, today's science says, is in perfect conformity to latest advances made in embryology. It further says, we placed it in a qarar-e-makin, a place of security. And we know today that the fetus is protected posteriorly by the spinal column, that the backbone, as well as the posterior muscles. And anteriorly, it is protected by the anterior abdominal wall, by the amniocorionic membrane, as well as the amniotic fluid, which protects the child. So the science today testifies that the child is well protected in the womb of the mother. It further says, we made the alaka into a mudga. A mudga means a chewed-like lump. So Professor Keith Moore took a plaster seal and made it look into a leech-like substance, initial stage of embryo, and then placed it between his teeth. He bit it to make it appear like a mudga, a chewed-like lump. And when he saw it, the teeth marks, it resembled the somites from where the nerves develop. And the Quran continues, we made the mudga into izama bones, then clothed the bones with lahem, that is flesh. Then we made it altogether a different creature. So what does the Quran mean that we made it into altogether different creature? Till this stage of mudga, izama, lahem, chewed like lump, bones, flesh, till this stage, today science tells us, the initial stages of development of a human being is similar to the development of a fish, rabbit, and many other animals. Only after this stage does the human development differ in looks, where we have a head, then we have limbs, then the Quran says, we made it into a different creature. Glory be to Allah, who is the best to create. Imagine, the Quran describes the various embryological stages in great detail. And Professor Keith Moore, he said that this description given in the Quran, based on shapes, alaka, leech-like substance, mudga, chewed-like lump, izama, bones, laham, flesh, is far superior to the divisions made in modern embryology, where we say stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, stage 4. It's difficult to identify. The description given in the Quran is far more superior and much more easy. And previously the scientists, they thought, it was in the 16th and 17th century, when scientists like Swammerdam, they thought that the sperm contained the miniature human being. The head of the sperm contained the miniature human being, and then it grew in the womb of the mother. Later on, when they came to know that the size of the ovum is bigger than the sperm, De Graafe, he said that the human being is present in the ovum and not the sperm. Later on in 18th century, Mau Paratus, he propounded the biparental theory that both the ovum and the sperm is responsible for the creation of the human being. They fertilize, they form the zygote, which the Quran has described in great detail. Furthermore, the Quran says in Surah Hajj, chapter number 22, verse number 5, that we have created the human beings from a minute quantity of clay, made into alaka, made the alaka into mudga, partly formed and partly unformed. This verse of the Quran was taken to Dr. Marshall Johnson, who is the head of the Department of Anatomy in Daniel Institute in Sir Thomas Jefferson University in USA, in Philadelphia. Now we have come to know in science that if at this stage we cut the embryo and we analyze the organs, we find some of the organs are formed, some are not formed. So Professor Marshall Johnson said, if we describe this stage of the embryo as a complete creation, it will be wrong, because some organs are not formed. If we label it as an incomplete creation, that's also wrong, because some of the organs are formed. So there's no better description than the description mentioned in the Quran, partly formed and partly unformed. In Arabic, it can also be treated as differentiated and undifferentiated. And Professor Marshall Johnson said that at this stage, some cells are differentiated, some are undifferentiated. Further, it's mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Sajda, chapter number 32, verse number 9, that we have given the human beings the faculty of hearing and sight. It's mentioned in Surah Insan, chapter number 76, verse number 2. We have given to the human being the gift of hearing, sight, and feeling. So the Quran first speaks about hearing, then it speaks about sight. And today science tells us the first sense to develop in a human being is the sense of hearing. By the 22nd day, the ear starts to formulate, and by the 5th month of pregnancy, it is completed. And later on, the eye splits open. That's in the seventh month of pregnancy. So the Quran is perfect in conformity with science. First come the sense of hearing, then come the sense of sight. There was an experiment done where a baby whose mother was a typist, a newborn baby was taken, and the mother of that baby was a typist, and that baby born to a typist was placed along with other 9 babies who were born to normal mothers who were not typists, and the typewriter was sounded. All the babies were scared except the baby of the typist, because the baby of the typist was used to hearing the typewriter in the womb of the mother. So the baby was used to it, so he wasn't scared. You know, there are many hadiths which say that the pregnant woman should read the Quran. Today science has confirmed that when the mother is pregnant, when the lady is pregnant, what she sees, what she hears, what she listens has an impact on the child. I'd just like to mention 2 more things before in my talk. The Quran mentions in Surah Qiyamah, chapter number 75, verse number 3 and 4, where the unbelievers say that after we have died, after human beings have died and have been buried and their bones have got disintegrated, how will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God, be able to reassemble our bones on the day of judgment? So Allah gives a reply that tell them, Allah can not only reconstruct the bones, He can even reconstruct in perfect order the very tips of your fingers. What does the Quran mean by saying Almighty God on the day of resurrection, He can not only reconstruct your bones, He can even reconstruct in perfect order the very tips of your fingers? It was in 1880 that Sir Francis Gold, he discovered the fingerprinting method. And he said that no 2 fingerprints, even in 1,000,000 human beings, can be identical. And today, people use the fingerprinting method, especially the police, the FBI, the CIA, the CID, to identify the criminal, the robber. And this fingerprinting method, which we came to know in 1880, Almighty God describes in the Quran 1400 years ago. He can not only reconstruct your bones, He can reconstruct in perfect order the very tips of your fingers. I would like to end my talk by giving the last example of Professor Takrata Kashan. Professor Takrata Kashan is head of the Department of Anatomy in the University of Shanghai in Thailand. And he spent a great deal of time in doing research of pain receptors. We doctors, previously we thought that only the brain was responsible for the feeling of pain. Recently, we have come to know that besides the brain, there are certain receptors in the skin which are called as pain receptors, which are responsible for the feeling of pain. Without the pain receptors, the human being cannot feel pain. That's the reason whenever a patient of burn injury comes to a doctor, he takes a pin and pricks it in the area of burn. If the patient feels pain, the doctor is happy. It's a superficial burn. The pain receptors, they're intact. If the patient does not feel pain, then the doctor is sad. The pain receptors have been destroyed. It's a deep burn. The Quran mentions in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 56, as to those who reject our signs, we shall cast them into the hellfire. And as often as their skins are roasted, we shall give them fresh skins so that they shall feel the pain. What does the Quran mean by saying that as to those who reject our signs, we shall cast them into the hellfire. And as often as their skins are roasted, we shall give them fresh skin so that they shall feel the pain. Indicating that there is something in the skin which is responsible for the feeling of the pain. And today, the scientists and medical doctors have discovered that there are pain receptors in the skin which are responsible for the feeling of pain. When this translation of the verse was given to Prophet Takrata Kashan, he said, it is impossible. How could a book written 1400 years ago mention about pain receptors? He could not believe in it. Later on, after verifying the translation and speaking with other scientists, he was so impressed with the Quran that in the 8th medical conference held in Riyadh, in the conference itself, he said, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. There's no God but Allah, and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the messenger of Allah. Wa akhiru da'wana, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. JazakAllah khair, Dr. Zakir Naik. Before I begin the question and answers, a little about myself. In 1996, I accepted Islam at the University of California, Berkeley. And the lecture which facilitated my acceptance of Islam was a fraction of this lecture. Had I heard this, I probably would have been overblown. And mashallah, some people are just given that gift. And you have been given that gift. I shouldn't praise people in their presence, but. Now, back to the question and answers. In order to make this run as smoothly and quickly as possible,